The popularity of what became known as Race and Hillbilly Records caused talent scouts and record producers to head into the Mississippi Delta. It was the cradle of the blues, maybe some of the most influential music ever created in America.
Under southern skies, working from sun to sun, and I can hear the Delta calling from the light of a distant star, and I can see my future. Oh, I can feel my past when Henry plays his steel guitar. Oh yeah, well.
The Delta is this riddle of contradictions. It's just, you never can quite figure out why things happen the way they do. The place was a howling wilderness a century ago, and it took an enormous amount of work to clear the Delta of the cypress swamps, to plant it in cotton, and it was an oppressive culture for the working person, both black and white. And the experiences were so vivid there, I think, in that the oppression was so great that people had to learn how to cope with it on another level. And I think that the music grew out of a kind of desperation, but also that kind of hope that they could endure. And I think the music was what helped people endure.
Beginning in the late 1920s, portable recording equipment was used to capture the music of a wide range of country blues artists. The results were amazing.
I got down the road. Oh, when I got down, she's laying on the cooling floor. I grabbed up my suitcase. I said, I took out down the road. You know, look like 10,000 people were standing around the burying ground. I didn't know a little girl until I let her down. Looked like 10,000.
Sunhouse, for me, is where the blues begins. He just tapping into something that was as primal and as rich and as painful as any music you could ever hear on earth.
Till the good Lord sun went down, I didn't have a soul to throw my arms around. I didn't feel so bad until the good Lord sun went down.
Sunhouse, I see him as like a little bit confused. His songs of a very spiritual nature and of a very bluesy nature. He sings like John the Revelator, just standing there singing like, you know, those, and those things are just like, just so eerie. Especially to hear him just like put the guitar down and just stand up, because he didn't play much guitar. He just would just, if he didn't play, he just had him singing. He said, who's that riding? John the Revelator.
Tell me who's that riding? John the Revelator. Tell me who's that writing? John the Revelator wrote the book of the seven seals.
What he just does, there's no words that can describe what he's doing. You gotta see it.
John the Revelator. Tell me who's that writing?
The blues and gospel sounded the same back then. The licks all the same deal, so it's like they're both kind of like fighting with each other. And Sunhouse was like kind of like in this kind of like musical purgatory.
And I think that, like a lot of blues people, he felt obligated to sing a certain amount of spiritual music to be able to pay for the misbehavior that blues seemed to be, you know.
Go tell my disciples to meet me in Galilee. Now,
Sunhouse was a preacher. And when you find musicians who both do sacred music and blues, you're dealing with a culture that says they can't fit together. You have to choose. And you're dealing with one person who can't choose because he actually feels both. By the time you get a recording of a Robert Johnson, you're recording a young musician, a very young musician, and you're recording a young musician who makes up his own songs.
As a young man, Robert Johnson was influenced by both Son House and a fellow blues man named Willie Brown. Johnson grew up to be one of the most prolific writers and inventive guitarists of Delta blues.
I remember the stories about Son House and Robert Johnson would come into play when Willie Brown and they would just laugh at him. Oh, you a blues man. And somehow Robert Johnson took that personally and went somewhere and made a deal with the devil, so they say.
Does he write good songs? No, he writes great songs. Does he sing good? No, he sings as good or better than anybody. Does he play good? Amazing. You know what I mean? So he just hit all of these bullseyes.
I mean, come on in my kitchen, stones in my pathway, love in vain. I mean, these are songs as well as just blues. They're not just well-played blues. There is something else. He's the bark of the blues.
With a suitcase in my hand. Now, Tookie, that's the most, one of the most brilliant lyrics ever written. Start with, and I followed her. It's like a continuation of a beginning. Oh, I followed that girl to the station. With a suitcase in my hand. Well, you know, it's hard to tell, it's hard to tell. When all your love's in vain, all my love in vain.
I mean, he's a giant. He was duly influencing everybody that heard about him at the time, and his impact for generations after his records were re-released is, you can't even calculate it.
All my love's in vain. The train, it left the station with two lights on behind. When the train, it left the station with two lights on behind. Well, the blue light was my blue, and the red light was my mind. Oh, my love.
In 1925, Pine Top Smith started a craze for boogie-woogie piano with his record Pine Top's Boogie.
Pine Top Smith and Mead Lux Lewis, Albert Ammons, and Pete Johnson, these are all great piano players who developed a boogie-woogie sound that later on was appropriated by rock and roll and by jazz, and it was very popular in the 1930s.
The success of Race and Hillbilly Records led record producers to record and sell music back to a variety of ethnic groups. In the late 20s, some of the first Cajun artists, like Joe and Cleoma Falcone, Dennis McGee, and black accordionist Amade Ardoin were recorded. In Texas, the first Tejano musician, Lydia Mendoza, was also recorded and became known as the Sparrow of the Poor People.